Hi. So, as we have discussed that there is a hierarchy of blocks and threads per block, which defines the grid of threads. So, looking at how the arrangement can be thought of pictorially, we have this n number of blocks. Each block is comprising 256 threads, as you can see in the picture. All of the threads are trying to progress their computation in parallel, and this is how the threads are indexed here. So, now let's just go back to the code here, the vector add kernel program once again. So, we have a line here which says I equal to threadIdx.x plus blockDim.x blockDim.x star blockIdx.x. So, these are again internally defined variables threadIdx, blockDim and blockIdx, and I is a local variable which is being used by this kernel to compute the global ID of a thread, of a CUDA thread. Now, let us go back to this picture of thread arrangement and try and understand what is happening. So, for every thread, I have a value of its block number. So, for example, any of these threads whose global thread ID I want to compute. So, for block 0, I have threads numbered from 0 to 255. So, for all these threads, the block ID is 0, the block dimension is 256, and the thread ID is any of the possible values from 0 to 255. Okay. Now, coming back to the earlier slide, we discussed that blocks can be numbered as triplets. That is why we have this facility of blockIdx.x. In this case, we are only doing everything in one dimension. So, block IDs are all linearly numbered. So, I only am defining block IDs using the x dimension. So, for all the threads inside this block, we have them with the block ID 0. For all the threads in the next block, we have them with the block ID 1. All the threads in the last block have the block ID n minus 1. The block dimension has been already set as 256. Now, again for block dimension, I can have a hierarchy. Block can be multidimensional. Only in that case, the block IDs are actually triplets, but here it is only in a single dimension. So, it is basically 256. Here I have block ID 0, and whatever is the actual thread ID comes here. So, for the first block, the value of I evaluates to be equal to the thread ID, right. For the second block, the value of I evaluates to its own thread ID plus, since the block ID is 1, so the own thread ID plus a 256, right. So, essentially what is this I? If I can think of all these threads arranged together and I am making an arrangement of their ordering, so then the their thread IDs would be 0 to 256 here, followed by 0 to 255 here, this should be 256, this should be 255 plus 256, like that, right. So, that is the value that gets stored in I. So, it is the global thread ID. So, that gives me the actual ID of the thread, and with that value of I can decide that this thread will act on which element of the arrays. So, using this notion of blocks and thread per blocks, I am dividing the arrangement of threads hierarchically. Finally, when I do, I have to give the actual computation, I have to compute from this hierarchy what is the exact ordering of this thread, and that is defined by this global thread ID that I do compute with this kind of an access expression. And then this thread ID is used to decide this corresponding thread will act on which elements of the data points in A and B. So, as you can see that, let us say I pick up thread thread 1 here of block 0. If I take thread 1 of block 0, so that will give me I as 1. So, this will operate on C1, I mean it will write to C1 the value A1 plus B1. If I pick up something, let us say threadIdx1 from block 1, so essentially that is 1 plus for blockIdx, I have the value 1 times block dimension 256, so 256 plus 1, that would be the value of I here, and accordingly suitable locations in AI and BI will be used to do the addition, right. So, in that way every thread maps to a different unique ID, and using that unique ID it is decided which data elements will the thread work on and which data element will the thread update. So, with this background we have possibly a clear understanding of how vector addition is done in parallel using a simple CUDA program. Now, let us try and understand this notion of thread and block definition, I mean in a more detail with respect to CUDA syntax. So, as we have discussed that the packing of threads together is defined as a grid, the grid is divided into blocks, and inside each block I have a number of threads as the threads per block, right. Now, things can be up to 3 dimensions here, that means I can have a grid defined in 3 dimensions. So, if I say grid dim, then that is the number of blocks in the grid. If I say grid dim dot x, that means the number of blocks in dimension x, considering that the grid is multidimensional. If I say block dimension, that is the number of threads per block. If I say block dimension dot x, that means number of threads per block in dimensions x of a multidimensional block. So, for single dimension, the definition of block and block dim dot x is same. So, whenever we are talking about a single dimension of block, if I say block dim, it is essentially meaning block dim dot x. If I say thread idx dot x or block dim or block idx dot x, essentially they are all talking about the single linear dimension. So, by default if I am using a single value instead of a triplet in definition of thread ids or block ids, I can access them using blockIdx.x as well as threadIdx.x variables. So, in that way for a single dimension I have blockIdx.x meaning the number, the block number for a given thread, and threadIdx.x meaning the thread number for the thread inside a block. So, for any thread it has got its own values of this variables threadIdx.x and blockIdx.x considering a single dimension. So, if I have a hierarchical arrangement of the grid divided into blocks and threads per block both in single dimension, then for any thread I will have a value of blockIdx.x and threadIdx.x. This along with block dimension can be used to find out the global thread ID, that is the summary. If I am considering the grid to be packed in multiple dimensions, 2 dimensions or 3 dimensions, then the blocks will be arranged as per following a triplet or duplet arrangement. Accordingly, we will have definitions for blockIdx.x, blockIdx.y. Similarly, threads can be packed inside a block in 2 dimension or 3 dimension. Accordingly, we shall have values for threadIdx.x, threadIdx.y, threadIdx.z like that. So, for this vector add code, the code is executed by all threads in the grid. Every thread has a unique combination of block IDX and thread IDX. Essentially, for no thread, I will have all these values same, I mean block ID and thread ID, all of them will not match. Hence, you will evaluate to the global thread ID, that is the unique value of I, which is private for that thread, I mean it is unique to that thread. For example, we already have here, like suppose I pick up a thread with ID 253, a thread with ID 253 in the block 1, then I can see that for this thread the block ID is 1, block dimension it's only one dimension, so blockDim.x is 256 and threadIdx.x is 253. So that will give me a value of I, and this will decide exactly 256 plus 253. So I have 509. So that's the value of I, and it decides exactly which of the A and B array positions are to be added by this specific thread. So that's kind of a summary of how threads are getting declared and arranged inside a CUDA data space, and how the threads get to know what is their index in the overall data space, and how that index can be used to decide what are the data points on which the thread is going to act on. Following this, we have some discussion on the different keywords that are to be used for declaring CUDA functions. Now, if you have noticed that for this vector add, we have used a keyword here highlighted in green, that's global. Global is a keyword followed by the standard definition, a standard function like definition, return type is void, because of course, this is a device style, a device function, that means it's a kernel that will execute on the GPU device. It has its read and write parameters, the device memory locations which are to be passed to these pointers, and this keyword global actually is indicator of the nature of this function. So, this is a CUDA keyword, and this keyword helps to define what is the scope of the function. Overall, for such functions, we have three possible keywords: device, global, and host. So, when I say the keyword is device for a specific function, we are meaning that it is a function that can execute on a GPU device. It is callable only from a device. Note that the function we used had a keyword global, which meant it is a function that can execute on a GPU device, but it is callable only from the host. That is why we had a host side vector addition program, which was actually calling the kernel or launching the kernel on the GPU device. So, that is like functions with global keyword. There can be function which are device keyword level, they mean that they are kind of kernels that can be launched from other kernels, basically some other device function. So, that is why it is only callable from a desired function, and it also executes on a device function. Now, if I use this keyword host, so that means it is normal program execute on the host side, that is a CPU, and they are only callable from another function execute on the CPU, that is essentially a host type function can call another host type function, and they are to be labeled by the keyword host. So, these are the three different possibilities of CUDA functions with respect to their scope. Now, by default, every function is definitely a host function. If nothing is specified, that means the default is host. I mean, it is a normal C function. A function can be declared as both host and device. Now, when will you like to do that? And the definition will look like this. I have the declaration with host followed by device, then the function's normal declaration. If it is given like this, then the runtime system will generate two object files. By default, as we have seen, that the host side function is compiled by the normal CPU's C compiler and linker pipeline and gives a host side object code, whereas the device function is compiled for the GPU to create a separate object code. But if for a function we have both this host and device levels tag, then the runtime system will generate two object files. One can be called from host functions and another can be called from device functions. So, since it may be required that the function is such that sometimes a host port calls it and it will execute on a GPU, or it can also be such that at the runtime some other GPU device function calls it. So, for having that kind of a facility, I may like to have two of these object files ready and available with me. Now, another important thing is this functions which are declared as global, by default, if you look into their definition. So, this global tagged functions are essentially device functions which can only be called from host side functions. But if you are using CUDA 5.0 with compute capability 3.5 or higher, then a global function can also be called from the device using the CUDA kernel semantics, that is these notations, if you are using dynamic parallelism. So, in case I want the global functions to be also called from other CUDA, from a device side functionality, that requires this support of dynamic parallelism. So, to break it down, what will that mean? Let us just explain. First of all, what is a device function? It can have a return type other than void, but global functions must always return void. This is because a device function is basically called by another function that is executing already in the GPU. As you can see from the device keyword, it is a function which will be executed on the GPU and it is called by another function from the GPU side only. It is called by a device side program. So, definitely in that case, this function executing on the GPU can return back to the callee, which is also resident on the GPU. But that is not allowed when I have a device function executing and it is being called from the host side, basically a device function with global keyword, because if the callee is resident on a separate processor, whereas this function is executing on the GPU card physically. So, that is why the device function can have return type other than void, but global function must always return void, and we have to use CUDA memcopy directives to copy back the values to the host side callee. But as we have discussed earlier, that global functions can be called from device type functions in case I have this higher levels of CUDA, and this is known as dynamic parallelism. Let us understand what will happen in that case. So, suppose a CUDA kernel is executing. So, that means it has launched multiple multiple threads. So, let us say there are n number of threads that it launched, that are launched, and in case I have this support of CUDA dynamic parallelism, then this device side function can also launch a global function, and that would happen. And suppose this global function is going to launch m number of threads in each invocation. So, overall I will have effectively n times m number of thread launches, because these m number of threads of the global function will be launched for each of the n threads that are already executing in by the callee device function. So, that this is known as an example of dynamic parallelism in CUDA, which has come into existence from CUDA 5.0. So, with this we have discussed the classification of the different possible types of CUDA functions that we can have based on from where they are called, and we have provided a discussion on how a basic CUDA function can be written, how a CUDA kernel operates, in conjunction with a host program, how the host program can set up memory elements which are to be copied for as the necessary arguments for execution of a CUDA kernel. Following that copy, how a CUDA kernel is actually invoked, and once the CUDA kernel's execution is done, how the computed values can be copied back. So, with this we would like to end today's lecture, and in the next iteration we will like to go to a bit more advanced concepts of basic CUDA programming. Thank you.